Can you do an Assassin's Creed-style leap of faith in real life? Well, here's a guy doing it for real in real life, so it's at least theoretically possible, but your safety depends on what you are falling on and how high you are falling from. They say it's not the fall that kills you, but it's the M delta V over delta T. Okay, nobody says that but mathematicians, but still, this is describing how your momentum changes over time, or the impulse of impact. That is to say, if you can elongate the time over which an impact occurs, or decrease the speed at which the impact occurs, the ultimate force on your body or an object will be less. So if you're not jumping from too high a height and into something really soft that can slow you down, then you could probably do an Assassin's Creed leap of faith, but a small haystack probably won't cut it. Thanks for your question, Tommy Lee on YouTube. Now, what else do you guys have for me? Kristen Fredrickson on Twitter asks, always interested in TV's depiction of artificial gravity and how you do it or not in real life. Well, Kristen, we've actually been thinking about creating artificial gravity for some time, specifically in relation to orbiting space stations. Take, for example, the recent sci-fi film Elysium. It shows an orbiting space station modeled after a NASA design dating back to the 1970s called a Stanford Torus. These space stations would create artificial gravity by spinning. What the astronauts would feel, their artificial gravity, would actually be the centrifugal forces pressing up on their feet from being pressed up against the walls of the spinning space station. It's kind of like being in a large carnival ride. We've actually done tests on people to figure out how much artificial gravity we'd be able to take on a spinning space station. According to the math, as long as the spokes are long enough, the space station itself doesn't have to spin very fast, and any spin below 2 revolutions per minute, we don't get sick. So that's good. What's next? Rami Unger on Twitter asks, what are some ways the TARDIS could exist? How could it work? While we could tackle the huge problem of how to time travel, we did sort of cover that in my video on Interstellar, so let's take a different aspect of the problem. How could a TARDIS actually be bigger on the inside? Famously, Doctor Who's TARDIS is a time-traveling London police box that allows the various iterations of the Doctor to traverse time and space. And curiously, the phone booth-sized thing can fit a whole ship's worth of tech inside it. How? Geometrically, what the TARDIS basically is a police box with a police box's surface area, but not a police box's volume. Let's look at this in 2 dimensions to get a better picture. So in 2 dimensions, it's kind of like this. Imagine you have a flat sheet of paper and you cut a disc out of it, but then you replace that disc with a 3-dimensional hemisphere. Now, the 2 circles have the same circumference, but the hemisphere has a different surface area. In 3 dimensions, this is like having a bigger interior volume. And the universe might actually have this TARDIS space. Physicist Mikko Levinto at the University of Helsinki in Finland thinks that these differently volumed space areas can explain not only why the universe is expanding, but expanding at an accelerating rate. It's a theory without much proof, but it's interesting nonetheless, and you get to say TARDIS space. As always, thanks for your great questions, and remember, you can always send me more questions for the Ask Kyle file on Twitter at SciFile, and I will answer them as fast as TARDIS space allows. Why? Because science.